E gridate, 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 sai a me che me ne importa. E parlate, parlate, io fingerò di ascoltarvi per l'ennesima volta.
Professor Mosler, secondo lei i deficit pubblici sono la vera causa della crisi europea?
In your opinion, are public financial deficits the real cause of European crisis?
If Europe had been able to immediately respond to the beginning of the crisis by increasing their deficits, if they'd been able to have that political response, then the crisis would not have been, the financial crisis would not have spilled over into the real economy. Okay, so the cause of the crisis in the real economy, the cause of the rising unemployment, is always because the deficit is too small. Okay, now, but the deficit didn't necessarily cause the financial crisis that caused the drop in aggregate demand. So, for example, you could have a massive bank failure because the bank made bad loans. And that could cause a big drop in credit availability for the rest of the economy. But the government can always respond to that drop with either a tax cut or a spending increase to make sure that aggregate demand, that spending stays high enough so that we're at full employment and high levels of output. So I'm not trying to duck your question, but the idea of the deficit causing it is the problem. You have to define the problem. And if you define the problem as high unemployment, the answer is yes, it was caused because they did not make the adjustment to let the deficit go up. If you define the problem as a bank failure and shareholders losing money, no, that could be bad loans or that could be something else. So we have to more narrowly define the problem for me to give you an exact answer to your question. So I hope that's helpful.
L'euro ha avuto un impatto sulla crisi finanziaria europea? Se sì, come è accaduto?
Did the euro currency have an impact on the European financial crisis? If yes, how did it have this impact?
Okay, so what the dynamics in Europe with the euro were that Europe it was set up based on the traditional mainstream export model. And what an exporter does, what somebody who desires to export does, is they keep fiscal policy tight. And the Maastricht Treaty was set up to keep fiscal policy tight, 3% deficit limits, 60% debt to GDP, with some enforcement provisions for violators. At the same time, and this is much what Germany did when Germany was had its own currency, the mark, and was exporting. However, what this policy does is it keeps domestic demand down, but it also and it makes the currency harder to get. So it makes the currency strong. And so what Germany did, what Japan did, what China does is they then go out and buy foreign exchange to keep their currencies weak enough, to keep their real wages and their real costs, which is mainly wages, low enough so that they can net export. Now, this is to the detriment of the population as a whole, but it's to the benefit of certain specific exporters. So the basic model is keep fiscal policy tight and then sell your currency, buy the currency of your target market to keep your currency, your real wages low enough so that you can then net export. And at the same time, you accumulate reserves of the targeted export region. So Germany, for example, had something like 50 billion US dollars back when that was a lot of money in 1998 when the currencies were irrevocably locked as part of the strategy. Japan, probably close to 2 trillion in foreign exchange reserves, same as China. All right, now, so the euro, so what they did was they copied that model with the tight fiscal policy, but they can't go out and buy dollars. The ECB can't buy dollars or yen or anything else because that would be an ideological violation. It would make it would give the appearance that the dollar is backing the euro if the ECB was building dollar reserves or building yen reserves, right? Then you'd say, oh, look what's behind the euro. Yeah. The yen, they wanted their currency to be the reserve currency like the dollar. The dollar doesn't build any, we don't build any foreign exchange reserves. And so they just did the tight fiscal policy and didn't buy the foreign exchange. No, so what happens? The currency just goes up to the point where your exports never materialize. And as your competitiveness increases and your wages get more competitive and your exports start to go up, the currency just gets stronger. And so that's what's been going on now since the beginning. Well, the euro was 85 to the dollar at one point. Now it's 130 after being as high as 160. So in general, this policy has thwarted, has kept Europe from becoming the net exporter that it desires. And let me add one more thing, and that is, if you're going to be a net exporter, then you've got to own the foreign exchange of the other country, okay? And nobody has your currency. So if you want your currency to be a reserve currency, you have to be a net importer. Because the United States, for example, we import and we pay for it in dollars, and then so the rest of the world has those dollars. And you had Germany and all the European countries were building dollar reserves, exporting to the U.S. and Japan and China. And so by running a trade deficit, everyone else gets dollars because they sell us tires and cars and we give them dollars, dollar deposits at the Fed. And so the dollar becomes the world's reserve currency because they're using it for reserves to drive exports. Okay, Japan, now why isn't the yen a reserve currency? Big, powerful country, second largest economy in the world. Because they're a net exporter, so nobody has any yen. Everybody is short yen. When you're an exporter, the world is short your currency. So here's Europe, want it to be a net exporter, which means everyone is going to be net borrowed in euros. And at the same time, they want the euro to be the reserve currency where everybody has euros. Well, you're talking out of both sides of your mouth. It can't happen. You're just violating the accounting identity.
Penso che questo risponda anche alla prossima domanda. A cosa sono dovuti i danni causati dall'euro? Cioè, da cosa dipendono?
I suppose that this also answers to the next question, which is, what are the damages created by the euro related to, meaning what they depend on?
Yeah, so what happens is the export channel is not there. So Europe has very large savings desires, large accumulations of savings. So where can they come from? You know, any currency is just assets and liabilities. It's a simple spreadsheet. So some other sector has to be net borrowed for the domestic sector to be net save. And it's not going to be the foreign sector. You're not going to be able to export. You're just going to make the euro stronger. And the government's not allowed to do it.
What's the question?
When I would just look at the numbers, I think for Europe to be at full employment today, spending has to increase by 5 or 6% of GDP. So that's net spending. So that either has to come from the government cutting taxes and raising spending, or it's got to come from exports, or it's got to come from credit expansion of the private sector. And I don't see any of those three happening under the current political leadership. And so I see it going nowhere.
Una domanda collegata ad una osservazione del professor Brancaccio. Il professor Brancaccio dice che secondo alcuni economisti MMT l'importazione di capitali stranieri sarebbe un elemento positivo. Secondo lui queste considerazioni non sono sufficienti, perché prima di tutto sarebbe necessario ridefinire i trattati sullo scambio delle valute e inoltre importando capitali stranieri si rischia di cedere i propri asset strategici. Cosa ne pensa e cosa risponde?
Now, a question linked to something Professor Brancaccio said about MMT. According to him, some MMT economists say that it's a good thing to import foreign currencies. In his opinion, this is not enough. First of all, he says it's necessary to redefine currency exchange trades. In addition, by importing foreign currencies, there's the risk for a country to lose its strategic assets. What's your opinion, and what do you answer?
Well, first, let me say that all currencies are MMT currencies, because MMT describes every currency. No matter how it's managed, MMT will describe what's going on. So, look, you know, this goes back to basic fundamental economics. And economics, and I like to say, is the opposite of religion. In economics, it's better to receive than it is to give, right? We measure success by material wealth, goods and services. And so you have to separate the real goods and services, which would be cars and houses and handbags and personal service, you know, trainer services, from the nominal, which are just data in spreadsheets, which is the currency. The currency is not a real, it's just nominal, okay? It's just a number. You don't actually eat it or drive it or do anything with it. It's just a number. So your real wealth is best described, I like to use my hand here, is your pile of stuff. So your pile of stuff consists of everything you can produce yourself domestically at full employment. Plus, your pile gets bigger when the rest of the world sends you real goods and services, minus your pile gets smaller when you have to send the rest of the world goods and services. So your real wealth is your domestic production plus your imports minus your exports. Your exports are the real cost of production. Now, that doesn't mean they're bad, because but you have to remember the whole purpose of exports is to get imports. So if you can effectively use your exports to get more imports, that's called improving your real terms of trade. Your real terms of trade is what has classically been talked about, which is how much can you get for what you send out? You're going to be sending out exports. You want to get as much possible for it. You want the best real terms of trade for your nation. So if you can send out one Prada handbag and in return get one Mercedes, that's a pretty good exchange. Right? Your real terms of trade are good. And so Italy's always had, with its luxury exports, exceptionally high real terms of trade and done very well. And however, if you were just going to send out your exports and not import anything, what's the point? You might play golf instead of building something to send to somebody and not use it. Okay, so I don't know if that exactly answers your question. And your foreign exchange that you build when you export, the only way you get any real benefit from that is if you buy something with it. Just piling up numbers in bank accounts does you no good until you spend it.
Parliamo di austerity. È possibile ridurre allo stesso tempo tasse e deficit? Quali sarebbero le conseguenze di queste riduzioni? E ci sono altre opzioni?
Let's talk about austerity. Is it possible to reduce public deficit and taxes simultaneously? What will be the consequences of these reductions? Do we have some other options?
Right. So if you line up 1,000 economists, economic forecasters, every one of them will agree that if you cut spending, the economy will get worse. GDP will go down, unemployment will go up. Every one of them will agree that if you raise taxes, unemployment will go up, the economy will get worse. Every single one agrees. There's no disagreement. Okay, so why would anybody want to do that if everyone knows it makes the economy worse? And Europe has proven it now. Has proven the obvious, that if you take money away from people, the economy is worse. So why would they want to do it? Because they see some other benefit to reducing the deficit. Now, what I'm saying is there is no particular benefit or not benefit of the deficit being larger or smaller when you're, you know, for the issuer of the currency. Now, Italy and the other members have put themselves in a position like U.S. states where they need to rely on the European Central Bank to do all the financing. And finally, that's happened. And now, right now, for all practical purposes, the central bank, the ECB, is guaranteeing the debt. So solvency, going broke, not being able to fund yourself, is not a problem as long as the central bank is there. And that's true with every country in the world. That's just how currencies work. Once you've recognized the solvency problem is not there, then what difference does it make if the deficit's larger or smaller? Okay, it doesn't make any difference. What makes a difference is whether unemployment is high or low. What makes a difference is what your real terms of trade are. Are you getting the most for your exports? You know, and what is the distribution of your income? And your wealth, is your institutional structure causing certain people to get all the income and other people to get nothing? It's all institutional structure that does that. It's not some natural order of things that creates, bond traders. This is something created by government, you know, that doesn't actually need to be there. And lawyers and tax accountants and all these things are created by our legal structure that sets up taxes so complicated that we, you know, empower lawyers to make millions of dollars a year trying to figure it out. We don't have to have this. Okay, but to get back to your question on austerity, it's driven by this myth that the deficit itself has something wrong with it. And that was reinforced by the structure of the European Union, where it was set up to turn Italy, France, Greece, Germany into what are like U.S. states. And just like the U.S. states, just, you know, Just like California can go broke, or Connecticut, Greece, or Portugal, or even Germany can go broke if things go wrong. However, the European Central Bank doesn't run out of euro any more than the Fed runs out of dollars. If you, wasn't too long ago, the European Central Bank just spent 1 trillion euro. Did anybody ask if that was someone's tax money? Did anybody ask if they borrowed it from China? No. They just credit numbers on the account. There's no question the European Central Bank can spend without being constrained by any kind of revenues. The only thing that constrains it is the political will. If the finance ministers say you can't write a check for this bank, then they can't write it. If the finance ministers say you can write the check, then that check will clear and the funds will go through. Same thing with the Federal Reserve. Chairman Bernanke was asked where the bailout money came from for the banks, and he said, we just mark up the numbers in their accounts. It's not taxpayer money, it doesn't come from anywhere. And that's exactly right. All central banks spend their own currency simply by making data entries into their computer. Okay, and the question to do it or not do it is political. There's no market involved, there's no discipline from interest rates or anything like that. And if you notice, all the central banks set their own interest rates. They have a meeting and they take a vote and the rate is zero, or the rate is one, the rate is two. That is, there's no market driving that rate. Okay, and so they're completely in control. The currency itself is a very simple public monopoly. And the central bank is the monopolist who controls the monopoly. And a monopolist is always price setter and not price taker. And a monopolist always determines value for his own product by telling you what you have to do to get it. He's the only one with it. Okay, and so you know, this austerity, I just call it a crime against humanity at this point. It's awful. And it's all done on either a misconception or, you know, some horrendous plan that I can't even imagine anybody would actually have. From all the people I've talked to, I think it's a misconception, but I could be wrong. It could be some grand conspiracy. I just, you know, I'm too little a person to know. I'm not in those circles.
Come possiamo ridurre la disoccupazione in Europa o in Italia?
How can we reduce the unemployment rate in Europe or in Italy?
Okay, so to reduce unemployment, the Maastricht limits need to be changed. You need to raise the deficit limits so that they go from 3% of GDP, and my best guess is about 8% of GDP. Okay, unless those limits are raised, there's no way unemployment's going to come down. And if the European Union refuses to do that and continues to keep the limits at 3% and then force balanced budgets to get there,
I was able to run it,
then the only way to get the full employment would be to start your own currency again.
In the start bar,
go back to something like the lira. But even then, you've got to be very careful, because if the political leaders at that time have the same mindset as the European leaders today and want to balance the budget, it's going to be just as bad. Look, the United States has its own currency. England has its own currency. And what do? They undergo the same austerity. Okay, you've got to have leadership that understands unemployment is always caused by the budget deficit being too small. If you've got unemployment, the budget deficit is too small. You need to either cut taxes or raise spending, depending on your politics. You are not, for a given size government, spending is not high enough for people to pay their taxes and to save. And so the evidence is unemployment. And it's just a simple point of logic. There's no way around it. It's easy. Any third grader can understand this. And it's tragic what's happening. And again, a crime against humanity, whether intentional or not.
Concorda con l'analisi della crisi del professor Bagnai?
Do you agree with Alberto Bagnai's analysis of the crisis?
Well, I'm not sure exactly what it is, but the reason for the unemployment is because the deficits are too small. Now, sometimes the deficit needs to be larger, sometimes it needs to be smaller. All you do is count bodies in the unemployment line. If the line's too long, the deficit's too small. If the unemployment line gets too short and everybody has a job, you know, companies are trying to steal them from each other and the price of houses is going up every day, the deficit's too large. It needs to be made smaller, no matter what size it starts out at. Okay, so again, you have to define what the crisis is. To me, the crisis is the rise in unemployment, the loss of output, and the destruction of the culture. That part of the crisis is always caused by the deficit being too small for the given set of circumstances. Now, one day, a 1% deficit might be just perfect because the private sector is borrowing like crazy and expanding their credit at 5 or 6% a year. The next day, the private sector may have had all their credit cards taken away, and now you need an 8 or 10% deficit. The next day, foreign governments might be spending all their foreign exchange reserves, and you may need to run a surplus. It's going to change. But the right size deficit is the one that sustains full employment with reasonable price stability. And now I don't know if that's how he says it or not, but that's the case. That's the way it is.
Un'ultima domanda. È difficile credere che in Europa siano tutti sprovveduti ed abbiano fatto errori senza sapere quel che facevano. E allora viene da chiedersi, a chi conviene? Chi è che guadagna dall'eurocrisi?
The very last question. It's hard to believe that in Europe they don't know what they are doing, they do errors like this. And the question is, who is gaining profit from the crisis of the Eurozone?
I think everyone's losing for the most part. Now, you get some bureaucrats that are sustaining their lifestyle by having nice lunches every day and staying at nice hotels and getting some nice salaries, but that's a very minor part of what's happening. Every corporation, every industrialist would do much, much better at full employment. Output would be up within 5 years, it would probably double, and corporate profits would be higher, people would be living better with more real output, everybody benefits. You always want to grow the pie and have more to distribute. Right now, it's like we're in a fishbowl and the water's running out and the fish are getting frantic. They're running out of water. They're thrashing around. They're fighting with each other. You may have a few of them doing well, but with more water in that fishbowl, then they're all going to do well. And that's, and that's why I suspect some of the conspiracy theory about these people. The banks would do much better in a good economy where they could make loans and, businesses like your car industry was selling twice as many cars. Everybody does better. It's just a case of global suicide, economic suicide, where everybody's going over the same cliff. It's terrible. It's the worst I could have ever imagined. The losses right now from unemployment and our weak economy are larger probably in one year than all the losses from all the wars in history. Now, I'm not talking about the human life, although there is a lot of human life being lost now, but just the actual material losses. Nobody understands how prosperous the world really is and could be right now if we could just understand the currency and get ourselves, back to full employment and sustain full employment. Let me just add, a banking crisis cannot cause unemployment. Okay, a banking crisis cannot cause a drop in output. It's the response to the crisis that causes the drop in output. Banks are just numbers on pieces of paper, entries on spreadsheets. The real world is people getting up in the morning, growing food, and then eating it. People building cars and driving them. People building buildings and living in them. People going to hospitals and taking care of sick people. People doing all kinds of things. That's the real world. And just because a lot of numbers change on some spreadsheet in some bank from plus to minus doesn't mean that has to stop. That world is driven by sales, people being able to spend money, to buy output from, is compete for consumer dollars. And a bank failure should not take away the consumer dollars to prevent the corporations from competing for consumer dollars. It only does because of the policy response. And the policy response can always be a tax cut or a spending increase to make sure that we stay at full employment and maximum output. There's no excuse for not doing that, except that they don't understand the currency. And that's the tragedy of this whole thing. The best of times have turned into the worst of times over this tragedy of the currency.
This scenario looks even worse than a conspiration one.
Oh, yeah. And here you're facing an election where no matter who wins, they've all got it wrong. And I'm my fear is that it turns into what we call blood in the streets. They just push it hard enough and make it bad enough until blood in the streets is what stops them. And it's happened, many times in the last 100 years. And my biggest fear is that it gets pushed to that again.
Thank you very much, Professor Mosler.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.